The recording. So we are recording now from the Clegg Terrace neighborhood of Carmel, Indiana. That's the north side of Indianapolis. If you're zooming in, and we'd welcome anybody and everybody to zoom in Friday mornings, 8 o'clock Eastern, and participate in a diverse Bible study. So we have different points of view, different pastors in the room, and men, women, boys and girls, you name it. So we're going through the book of Corinthians right now, and we'd invite you to join us. The details can be found at clayterrace.org. That's clayterrace.org. And our videos are all linked there, as well as being on indychristian.tv channel on YouTube. So that said, Holly's going to pray for us, and then we're going to read 1 Corinthians chapter 5.
Let us bow in prayer. Heavenly Father, we give you thanks in all things, in all circumstances, knowing that you reach the hearts of mankind and that you speak to them about yourself, about the Savior who died for us, who rose for us, who intercedes for us, who loves us and covers our sins. And we come before Christ in this name, asking that you open up our hearts and minds to your wills, to your ways, to whatever you would have us to do today and the rest of our lives. Let us be able to hear your voice through the Bible and do your will through hearing your voice. Lord, we know you are the God of the impossible, and we just ask to bless Andy and all the people who are on the call or who usually are on the call or that will listen to this, that God will come to them in a special way because nothing is impossible with the Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Well, again, we're going to read through 1 Corinthians chapter 5. Let's see. I think, Eric, were you going to start us off?
Or Holly, okay, I can start. Okay.
Okay.
It is actually reported that there is sexual immorality among you, and such sexual immorality as it is not even named among the Gentiles, that a man has his father's wife, and you are puffed up. And have not rather mourned that what he who has done this deed might be taken away from among you. For I indeed, as absent in body, but present in spirit, have already charged as though I were present him who has so done. This deed.
Oh, you want to read four?
Okay, I'll read four. Just a second. When you are assembled in the name of our Lord Jesus, and I am with you in spirit, and the power of our Lord Jesus is present, the hand this man over to Satan, so that the sinful nature may be destroyed and his spirit saved on the day of the Lord. Your boasting is not good. Don't you know that a little yeast works through the whole batch of dough? That's seven.
Okay, purge out therefore the old leaven, that ye may be a new lump, as ye are unleavened. For even Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us. Therefore let us keep the feast, not with old leaven, neither with the leaven of malice or wickedness, but with the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. I wrote unto you in an epistle not to company with fornicators.
But I wasn't talking about unbelievers who indulged in sexual sin or are greedy or cheap people or worship idols. You would have to leave this world to avoid people like that. I meant that you are not to associate with anyone who claims to be a believer, yet indulges in sexual sin, or is greedy, or worships idols, or is abusive, or is a drunkard, or cheats people. Don't even eat with such people.
What business is it of mine to judge those outside the church? Are you not to judge those inside? God will judge those outside. Expel the wicked person from among you. So Pastor Jim Wright with the Warren Baptist Church is filling in for Andy, who Andy followed Jim, though, in the chain of the pastors that have led this Bible study over the years. So, Jim, good to have you back. So, what have you got for us this morning? We're continuing this from last week. And where did we leave off, Jim?
Yeah, so just kind of do a little recap, you know, from last week. There's a lot of questions, I think, that we have to answer in this question, in this passage. Is it ever right to judge? And clearly it is. Paul talks about that. So there are times for judgment. And if so, who should be judged? And so as we looked at last week, we're talking about believers. This is in the church. And of course, Neil knows, if you all know, I like to put little slides up there. So I'll throw these up here. So these were some preliminary questions we were looking at. Is it ever right to be judged? Is it ever right to judge? If so, what or who should be judged? Who should be judged? Why should judgment take place? How should judgment be carried out? And what is the process or the purpose of judging? And so I just kind of wanted to briefly go through some of that last week, and then we'll finish up the chapter. So the first question is who to judge. And if you go to verse one, it's actually reported among you that there is sexual immorality among you, the kind of sexual immorality that is not even tolerated among the Gentiles, a man is sleeping with his father's wife. And if you read the passage as we did, obviously this is a person in the church. Verse 13, he says, get rid of the one who is among you. So it appears that this person is a professed believer. They say they're a believer, identified as part of the church of Corinth. Apparently went to regular meetings in verse 8, which we'll hit here in a minute. Apparently partook of the Lord's Supper, because Paul references that. So I think the first thing that's really important that we clear up is that the person we're talking about, this is judgment within the church. This is amongst people who profess to be believers and who are part of the church family there. So I think that's very important for us to make that distinction here. And so we kind of keep rocking here along. We're judging this person, and notice too, I put on here because I think it's important, who's living in unrepentant sin. So obviously this person sleeping with his brother's wife, he is not repentant about this. Apparently it's a well-known fact. This is not something that's being covered up, because obviously Paul's heard about it. The church knows about it. So we have an unrepentant person. We talked last week that, you know, immorality in the Bible is basically anything outside of a sexual relationship between a husband and wife is condemned in the Bible, from Leviticus, Genesis, really onward. So there are no blessings in the scripture of any sort of same-sex marriage or pedophilia or bestiality or anything like that, or people having relations outside of marriage. Only marriage between a husband and a man and woman is the only thing that's sanctified and celebrated in scripture. So this man's obviously living in immorality and he's unrepentant about it. And I think that's a key we have to remember, because we all sin, except for Neil. He's pretty perfect. But
thank you. Hey, if you listen to my grandson, my grandson said that at Awana they asked him, like, hey, is everybody sin? And he goes, not my grampy. So, like, hey, you know, from the mouth of babes. Go, so, really? Yeah.
No, there you go. But we all sin. And as I said last week, I think Charles Swindoll, who I heard this from, we cannot be sinless in this life, but we can sin less. And so I think that's the challenge for all of us as believers is hopefully all of us here sin less now than we did 6 months ago or a year ago. And again, being tempted is not a sin. We all face temptation, but when we act on those temptations is when we cross that line into sin. So we're not talking though about a person that had a stumble or, you know, went to a small group and said, hey, I'm struggling with this thought or whatever. We're talking about an individual here who's living in a lifestyle of unrepentant sin. And I think a lot of times, I know this talks about a sexual immorality situation here, but I think even Paul later is going to reference other things. I mean, so I don't think you can limit it to just sexual immorality. You can have a person in the church who is a swindler, who is untruthful in his business dealings, and it's known in the community. Well, that's the same situation. If you've got a person who is not right in his business dealings, or you've got a person in the church who is known as a habitual liar, or a divisive person. In fact, Paul later is going to talk about removing, or he talks about removing divisive people from among you. So in this case, so it just happens to be this sin and immorality. But I think the big key here is it's a member of the church, a professing believer who is living in unrepentant sin. And this is something that is known. So this is not a call to go on a witch hunt here, but this is the situation. So when are we called to judge? Well, it's when it comes to light that there is a church member that is living in unrepentant sin. So Paul goes on here and he says, you know, and you are arrogant. He gets on the congregation. Shouldn't you be filled with grief and remove from your congregation the one who did this? So bottom line is, When it's known that there's immorality in the church or any sort of unrepentant sin, it should grieve the church. Since faith in Christ is living in unrepentant sin. And it, obviously this church is having the opposite reaction. They're arrogant. And I think this is an indictment on the church today, because again, I'm a firm believer that we are at the end. And we are seeing the falling away of the church. And a lot of our churches today celebrate their acceptance of immorality, quite frankly. And the answer that you hear is, well, we've evolved. We've evolved. And we're enlightened. We get it. You know, you people that believe that marriage is between a man and a woman, you just don't get it. You're old fogies. You're in the past. And I think we're seeing this in America where this is being celebrated that, and if you don't join the bandwagon, then, you know, you're just a relic and you're just a Bible thumping Christian or something like that. And, so I see that the attitude that the Corinthian church had is really what I'm seeing reflected, even today, in not only the Church of America, although that's the one we're most familiar with, but this seems to be around the world. You look at Europe, I mean, where the church was one time strong, it's practically non-existent. And you look around the world, you see this. So Paul, you know, these people think they're enlightened, that they've gotten beyond the Bible and that they get it and that this is okay and this is good. Maybe even, you know, we're celebrating this. And Paul says, you're arrogant. You just think that somehow you get it and you don't. You're messed up. And so he tells him, he says, even though I'm absent in the body, I am present in the spirit. And as one present with you in this way, I have already pronounced judgment on the one who has been doing such a thing. So notice Paul is pronouncing judgment. I mean, he's like, if you're not going to do it, I'm going to do it. This is wrong, and I am pronouncing judgment. So again, a lot of times people throw at us, you know, judge not. Jesus said that, but they never read the rest of that verse, that we are not to judge with a standard of judgment that we're not willing to be judged by. And the reality is and Jesus told his disciples, judge righteous judgments. We are called as believers to make righteous judgments. And those who often accuse us of judging, they judge. Everybody judges. Like I said last week, nobody here would probably go let your child or grandchild sleep at a crack house. Okay. And by saying, I wouldn't do that, well, you're judging, right? We all judge. But the question is, number one, according to Jesus, we should never judge with a standard we're not willing to be judged by. And also, though, there are times when as believers, we have to judge righteously. We have to say, this is wrong. This shouldn't be tolerated. And Paul is doing that. He's not disobeying Jesus because, again, is Paul living in immorality? No. Paul's not living a life of unrepentant sin. Doesn't mean that Paul doesn't sin. Clearly, he sinned. He was a man. But he was a man who also walked in humility and dealt with his sin. I always think back, I always tell people regarding Paul, I think Paul had an issue with a little bit of anger. Paul was, in my view, the type D personality. If you ever done personality studies, Paul, D people are dogmatic, determined, decisive. And I think that really describes the Apostle Paul. Wasn't a great experience for him, but one of my favorite stories to illustrate this is in the book of Acts. I'm trying to think the chapter right off the bat, but he is stoned and they drag him out of the city. They thought he was dead. And I always have to qualify stone today. Does not mean he smoked weed, okay? They threw rocks at people. You know, young people are like, really cool, Paul. No, we're talking about they threw rocks at him. They stoned Paul. They drug him out of the city. I think it's Acts 10 or 12. I have to find it. And they thought he was dead. His disciples, again, that's just people that followed with Paul, thought he was dead, and he wakes up. And if you remember the story, he gets up and goes back into the city. Now, honestly, if you stoned me, I would figure you didn't like me, and I would probably leave. I'd say, let's go somewhere else. But that's a dogmatic person, determined. And that's what made Paul so great. He was determined. But if you remember, there was the big dispute between him and Barnabas over John Mark on the second missionary journey, because John Mark left Paul and Barnabas halfway through their first missionary journey. And Barnabas wanted to give him a second chance. And obviously Paul felt no, maybe he felt he just isn't ready. I don't want to have this happen again. We've got to have this person with us. And if you remember, they had a strong disagreement. I mean, you know, Barnabas was a huge player in Paul's life. I mean, he's the one that introduced him to the disciples and got the disciples. I mean, Barnabas was such an encourager, and yet, you know, Paul just wouldn't have it, and they split up. And of course, Paul took Silas, Barnabas takes John Mark. And I've always argued that I think Paul had a little bit of an anger issue at times. He let his determinism and dogmatism maybe get the best of him, but again, to his credit, in his last letter, he talks about send John Mark. He is necessary for me. He's useful to me. And then Paul references Barnabas in his letters to the Corinthians again. So clearly they've made up and clearly they reconciled and moved forward. But so I'm not, you know, Paul definitely, I think, had his own struggles, I would argue, probably with anger. at times because of his dogmatism and determinism. The thing that made him so great also can be your Achilles heel at times. So this is not to say that Paul was a perfect man by any means. He struggled. I mean, he called himself the chief among sinners, right? And again, that doesn't mean that Paul was living a hedonistic lifestyle. It's just a simple fact, and you all know this, that hopefully the closer you get to the light, the more imperfections you see. Mm-hmm. And the closer we get to the Lord, the more we things that maybe we didn't think about in the past, we realize were there all along. Little sins, I call them little, but no sins little. But the closer you get to the light, the more it exposes it. And so when Paul makes that statement, he's at the end of his life. And I think he's walking closer to the Lord than ever. And so he's not making any bones about it. He still struggles with sin. Not that he's living in sin, but he still has those moments. So again, so Paul says, look, I pronounce judgment on this guy. And so he says, so when you're assembled in the name of our Lord Jesus, and again, Jesus talks about this in Matthew 16, when two or three are gathered in the midst of them, there I am in the midst of them, together my name, that passage is dealing with church discipline. So I think this is a reference to that. When you're assembled in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, I'm with you in spirit with the power of our Lord Jesus Christ. Again, Christ promises to be in the midst of church discipline issues. Hand that one over to Satan for the destruction of the flesh. Pretty harsh, but here's Paul's end goal, so that his spirit may be saved in the day of the Lord. So Paul's goal is always the restoration of the believer, and that should always be our goal. It is the restoration of the person. Now, you know, Paul says that his soul may be saved. I don't know if, I mean, you could argue that Paul, again, is even wondering, is this guy saved? And I think that is a question. I mean, how can a believer be living in unrepentant sin? I think, you know, sometimes we can get caught in a sin, but if you're a true believer, you're going to be miserable. And maybe this guy's not showing any misery, any remorse. So maybe there's even a question, is this guy even a believer? I don't know. And you know, John talks about this in 1 John. You can say anything. You can say you're a believer, but it's your actions that will give proof to that inward reality, right? I mean, I can say I'm a multimillionaire.
Hey, Jim.
My bank account doesn't agree. So again, so Paul's goal here is not to just kick people out of the church. It is to restore people. And I think that's to do that. So kind of summing up last little bit of this, why judge the unrepentant church member? The church should do it because it hurts our testimony. It hurts the testimony of the church when the church is allowing this to go on. I think the church in America today is weak and having no impact on culture because, unfortunately, it appears that large swaths of our churches today are accepting of unrepentant immorality in the church and even celebrating it. It hurts the cause of Christ. And,
hey, Jim.
And then
can I say something?
Example.
You know, this passage, it speaks. Some of you know some of our channel here, but when we became homeless here in Indianapolis, it was April. It was April of 2019. So one of the children that opened this home for us, we were staying in an hotel and I was doing Uber and wasn't making ends meet completely. That was the only job I had. And so the gentleman that opened our home for us, yeah, he's from Kenya. He's been in this city longer. He's a believer, but he's been known to live with so many women in his home. and he lived in the best man we lived. It destroyed the testimony. For us living there, it completely affected the whole ministry, the testimony of the ministry. I knew that, I didn't know at the beginning, but of course we stayed there for only 2 months, because as I was trying to figure out what to do, and I never wanted to leave my family alone there. It was not the best, but the witness of the community was, it was not good, because, and even up to now, a lot of believers in the city, I've always wondered, how do we correct this? Because he claims to be a believer, but it's contrary to the witness of the faith in our Lord Jesus Christ. So, and I've wrestled with that in this city a lot. I have really, we finally moved out, the Lord made a way, but the testimony there was completely not the kind of testimony you want for a good work of the gospel. Right. Sorry to me that I checked on that.
Yeah, I appreciate that. I mean, and it's sad, because it really does hurt the testimony of Christ, and it hurts the testimony of the church, because the world looks at that and says, well, why do I even want to be a Christian, right? What's the difference? Why should I join the church either? You know, who cares? And you're right. I think it really does hurt the ministry.
Well, so. And Jim, if I can jump in, so the thing that hurts the church is not just that one individual, but apparently in this situation, kind of the whole church was behind it, and they were proud of it. So they weren't trying to help him out of it. And we know there are how many chapters in 1 Corinthians letter. It's a long letter, and of course a really famous chapter in there about love and what is love and faithfulness and so forth. A lot of good things to be said, but most of the letter to the Corinthians was, you know, kind of first one illustration and then another as to their divisions in the church, which always works against them. Mm-hmm. Like in this case, there probably were some good folks in that church too, but obviously the church was well known for being supportive of this guy. So,
right.
Yeah, none of us just sin individually. You know, we have interdependency. I need you all. I need you all to be more Christ-like than I can possibly be on my own. So.
Yeah, you're right. We all live in relationship to each other. And we all have to be very mindful how we live our lives, actually, as a reflection on our church, right? On our church family too. And that's so important. So Paul's again, his thing, how to judge it is remove this guy from the fellowship. And so Paul goes on in verse 6, he says, your boasting is not good. Don't you know that, and this is where I think we stopped last week, Neil. Don't you know that a little leaven leavens the whole batch of dough? Clean out the old leaven so that you may be a new unleavened batch, as indeed you are. For Christ our Passover lamb has been sacrificed. Therefore, let us observe the feast, not with old leaven or with the leaven of malice and evil, but with the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. So what does leaven represent in Scripture? Does anybody know? Sin. Leaven is often used as a descriptor of sin in Scripture. It leaven is, and I'm kind of hot off of this because our Lord's Supper, I taught extensively on the seven feasts of the Jews and how the Lord's table is a reflection of those feasts. And so the first feast is on the 14th day of the first month. And that's Passover. And that's what Paul's referring to here as well. And the Jews, of course, celebrated that. as the remembrance of coming out of Egypt and the spreading of the blood of the lamb on the doorpost, the angel of death passing over. And so Christ, of course, is the Passover lamb. So when we celebrate the Lord's Supper, we are also reflecting back on Christ and what he did on the cross for us. And so on the 14th day of the first month, the first month being God designated that as the month they came out of Egypt. So God set their calendar. By the way, the Jews just, this is a side note, just celebrated Rosh Hashanah, which is the beginning of their new year, but that's based on the Babylonian calendar that they adopted and when they were in the Babylonian captivity, but that's another topic. But anyways, then after the Passover, it was a one-day feast, and then the next day was the Feast of Unleavened Bread, and that was a seven-day feast. And so what you were to do was to go throughout all your house and clean out all the leaven. And one of the things that feast illustrated was sin and how hard it is to get rid of sin, because leaven gets in the air. It's in all sorts of baking goods. And, you know, a Jewish person might think they got the leaven out of their house and they'd find some crumbs in the corner. So it was a big deal to try and get the leaven out of your house. And of course, leaven is like sin. If you get it in dough and it gets warm and you hit a little water with it, it just expands and grows. So this is, Paul's referring back to those two feasts, Feast of the Unleavened Bread, which Christ was buried on the Feast of the Unleavened Bread. And he died on Passover and was buried as they were starting the Feast of Unleavened Bread, which was a seven-day feast. And so Paul is referring back to that. And of course, they would be at this point celebrating the Lord's table. And we know that later because they had all sorts of fights and people getting drunk at the Lord's Supper. So that's why you should only use grape juice. I'm joking. Paul is saying, bottom line is what he's using the whole idea of leaven to say, look, a little leaven, i.e. this person living in unrepentant immorality, it messes up the whole dough. So it messes up the whole church when you're tolerating this. And we've already talked about this. So he's like, listen, get clean, you know, remove this person from your fellowship. He's tying it into the whole idea of leaven. Clean out the old unleavened so that you may be a new unleavened batch, as you indeed are. And I think that's Paul reminding us, you in Christ. And one thing I've always pointed out in this letter to the Corinthians, he never calls them sinners. I think one of my big hobby horses has been identity in Christ, that we are saints. Yes, we still sin, but the Bible calls us saints. And Paul never called the Corinthian church a bunch of sinners. He still called them saints. And right here, he says, as indeed you are a saint. Okay, in Christ, you are reconciled and redeemed, and you're a citizen of heaven and a member of God's household and adopted into God's family, and you're redeemed from the power of sin, and you're more than a conqueror, and all those things. That's who you are. And I would argue, I'm going to get preaching here, but I would argue that a lot of people, a lot of believers get caught in sin. Like, I just can't get out. Look, the problem is they don't know who they are. You know, when you grasp who you are in Christ, wow, that changes your whole mindset. I think most believers don't know who they are. I'm a soldier in Christ. I have the battle armor. Sin is not my master. I can say no to sin through Christ. My citizenship's in heaven. It's not here. I love my country, but my citizenship's in heaven. I'm a member of God's household. I have access to the throne room of grace. I am seated in the heavenlies. Paul says that. That's who I am. And I never grasped that until a few years ago. And when I finally grasped my identity, I am not, this one gets people, so Neil might say so. I am not a sinner. I'm a saint. Now, I'm a saint who may sin, but I'm not just a sinner saved by grace. And I used to say that a lot, but I don't say that anymore. And here's why, because I believe when a believer says, oh, I'm just a sinner saved by grace, what they're telling themselves is, well, I can't help it. I'm just a sinner. Mm-hmm. No, I'm a saint. The Bible says all throughout the New Testament always identifies believers as saints. And when Paul refers to himself as chief among sinners, he's referring into his past context of what he was and what he did. But again, you read it over and over to the saints in the church of Ephesus, to the saints at the church of Philippi, to the saints at the church of Corinth. We are saints, brothers and sisters. A sinner. And again, I started writing a book on this, but I never finished it. When you look at the Old Testament and the New Testament, sinners are people who are living in unrepentant sin. They are people who have never humbled themselves before God. Saints, though, are people who have humbled themselves before God and responded to God's gift of salvation. When you look at the Old Testament, the wicked versus the righteous, the wicked are unrepentant people. The righteous are repentant people. And I just think as believers, we don't a lot of times grasp that. And so we get in situations where I just can't help it. I'm just a sinner. No, I can through Christ. I am not just a sinner. I'm a saint. I've been redeemed. So I have the power to say no to those things. And so, again, that little phrase I think right there is, as indeed you are. You're not full of the old unleavened. You're a saint. And again, Paul's going to call them saints. So again, he's referring to these Jewish feasts that we celebrate at the Lord's table. And so we'll wrap this up here a little bit on the conclusion here. So obviously, we think that there were more than two letters to the Corinthians, maybe three or four. But the Holy Spirit did not have those included. I wrote to you in a letter not to associate with sexually immoral people. Notice the qualifier. I did not mean the immoral people of this world or the greedy or the swindlers or idolaters. Otherwise, you would have to leave the world. Again, how are believers to interact with unbelievers? Well, we have to. I mean, we can't share the gospel if we're not interacting with them. But on the other hand, we don't engage in sin with unbelievers. I grew up in a very fundamentalist, separatist culture. So we didn't smoke, chew, or go with the girls who do. We were saved under a very fundamentalist pastor, and I'm thankful in a lot of ways for my heritage. It also almost shipwrecked my faith at one point. I grew up on a conservative Christian college campus and grew up going to Bible conferences and missionary conferences. I went to one of the most strict Christian universities in the country. I left there after a year and a half with a faith that I felt it was all about. My view of God when I left that university was that God's angry, always waiting to thump me on the head if I had my hair on my ears, or if I wore jeans on Sunday. And I left with a view of a very angry God. Just give you a testimony. And I spent first year after I left school, I came here to Indiana to study music privately. I didn't go to church much. I went to a lot of very liberal churches when I did. And I actually served for 2.5 years in a very, what we would say, very liberal church. Our associate pastor, she hated the Apostle Paul. She proclaimed from the pulpit, this is not the word of God, and we cut and pasted. And I was there in that for 2.5 years. So I tell people I have my Christian experience, I've been on both ends. I have been on the fundamentalist, and I've also been in what you might call the very liberal church. Where was I going with that? So the separatist side of me was, you know, we don't do anything with the world. Well, Paul is saying, look, that's not what I'm saying. Because we can't have an impact on the world if we're not in the world, right? But we're not to be of the world. So we have to interact with unbelievers. We need to interact with unbelievers. I think one of the worst things that happened in the history of the church is the monastic movement. When all these people got in their little convents and monasteries and were basically separating themselves away from the world, I don't think that's biblical. We have to be salt and light in the world because we have to deal with it. And so Paul is saying, look, I'm not telling you to divorce yourself from people who are unbelievers, to just simply not have anything to do with them. And he expands this too beyond, because the context here was a man living in immorality, but he obviously, we're not dealing just with immorality. He says, you know, I don't mean the immoral people of the world or the greedy or the swindlers, idolaters. Otherwise, you'd have to leave the world. That was kind of the monastic movement idea. We'll just leave the world. And I think Paul right there would have been against that whole concept. So who not to judge? Well, we're not, again, I'm not running around to judge the people of the world. Okay, I think sometimes the church feels like we're here to judge the people of the world, and that's not our role. Again, because if you look at the next verse, or next verses, Paul's going to tell us, he says, actually, here's what I wrote to you. I wrote you to not associate with anyone who claims to be a brother or sister who is sexually immoral or greedy or idolater or verbally abusive or a drunkard or a swindler. So he expands it here because obviously the whole idea is don't associate with people who claim to be believers but are living in unrepentant sin. That this is all unrepentant sinful behavior. Immoral, greedy, idolaters, abusive, verbally abusive, drunkards, swindlers. Don't even eat with a person. You know, and again, so if we've got a man in the church that's being abusive to his wife, you know, that person needs to be confronted about that sin, or somebody who's an idolater, who you know, other things are more important than the Lord. So again, we're not to associate with people who identify as believers but are living in unrepentant sin. And again, some questions is, how should we respond to churches and denominations who are tolerating sinful behavior? My answer is, don't associate with them.
Hey, Jim.
Uh-huh.
So if you could feel free to put that screen back on there, if you don't mind.
Sure.
And I appreciate your PowerPoint. You know, I find this scripture really interesting because it says, do not even eat with such a person. Mm-hmm. And, you know, Jesus, how do I want to share this? So we know that Jesus, from reading the word, we know that Jesus broke bread with, you know, anyone and everyone, right? He broke bread with those who have sexual immorality, those who are greedy. I mean, it is, he associated with Judas. He associated with the lady who worked as a prostitute. I mean, right. And so I find this scripture very interesting because it almost seems counterintuitive to what Jesus did, you know. And while I do recognize, you know, that if there is, I do understand that when major sin shows up in the church, or sin shows up in the church, then the church has the responsibility to work through it and figure it out and deal with it. You know, I definitely don't live under a rock, and I recognize that. All I'm saying is that, I guess the point that I want to make is I find the scripture very, a bit odd, just for the sheer fact that, you know, Jesus ate and broke bread. And so I don't want to be legalistic in the sense that because someone has sexual immorality, I am not going to break bread with them. Of course, I'm going to break bread with them because Jesus broke bread with them. So, so that's where I'm coming from. Can you help me further interpret the connection here?
Well, clearly Jesus did associate with sinners, and he was called a friend of sinners, right? And so Paul told us, he's not telling us not to, you know, associate with those who are outside of the church, because how, otherwise how would we have an impact, right? I think when the when he says do not, and again, so we're talking here, when he says do not even eat with such a person, I think, Gina, my understanding would be, we're not talking about having going out to lunch where we're talking to that that unrepentant church member. Hey, I need to talk to you about what's going on in your life. Okay, this is really bothering me. I don't think we're talking about a one-off meal. I think the idea here is having a continual fellowship with a person in the church who claims to be a believer but's living in unrepentant sin. We're talking about having. Just, hey, all everything's come fine. Just come on in. Just be a part of the group. I think that's the idea of do not break bread with such a person. It's not that you may, it's not saying don't ever talk to them or deal with their sin, because that's what we need to do, right? And earlier he's again said, I'm not talking about people out in the world. Obviously, yes, Jesus broke bread with tax collectors and sinners, right? The thing is, he was a friend of sinners, and I think this is what, again, my separatist roots kind of missed. The sinners were attracted to Jesus, not because he indulged in their sin or approved of their sin, but because he was so righteous. They were like, what is different about this guy? And I think that's the big issue with the church. When the church tolerates immorality, it loses its attractiveness. Unbelievers are like, there's no difference between them. Why should I be involved in that? Does that help, Gina? I don't think it's.
I hear you. I think that, you know, what's interesting is that, God gave the entire book, the entire Bible.
Right.
Not just one scripture, right. You know, because for instance, he gave grace plus truth, mm-hmm. right? You know, he didn't just give grace. He didn't just give truth. He gave both.
Right.
And so when I see this scripture, I'm glad he didn't just give this one scripture.
Right.
Because there is other scripture that says, you know, that gives us guidance in how to address a sister or brother in, you know, where we pull them aside and we have a grace, we have a truth wrapped in love conversation with them to seek understanding before to be understood, to find out what's going on. And then to help address it and figure out what's going on and help them and to witness to them. And so I guess I'm really glad that, God gave us the entire Bible and not just a scripture like that, so that we can try to balance all of it. And I think that that is also very important when, you know, we live out our life, because I sure as heck can't say that I never sin. Of course I sin, sure. You know?
Yeah.
And thank God that I, now have a better understanding of, you know, repentance. But, and I think that we can really miss out on seeing the full person. Just like we could really miss out if we only focus on one scripture. We can also, I want to relate that to people. We can miss out on what God is doing if we just focus on one piece of that person and not the entire person. You know, if we just focus on one piece of sin and not all of it, right? You know, because I do think that, I mean, how many times have people come alongside, you know, all of us to help us grow and understand what's right and what God would not be in favor of?
I agree. I think, but I don't think there's a conflict between Paul and Jesus here. When I look at Jesus in Matthew 16, and he talks about a one-on-one, a brother who has wronged you, that you're to go to that person individually. If they don't listen, you take another brother or sister with you. And if they don't listen, then you take it to the church. And then ultimately, if they don't listen, they are removed from the church. Okay. So that's a one-on-one.
Yeah.
In this situation, I see this as a person who is living in unrepentant sin. That's a public sin that's known to the church. But I think, again, I would agree with you, Holly, Gina, that, you know, the elders should go to that person and say, hey, we have a real concern here. Mm-hmm. There should always be an attempt to restore. And if that person, and maybe the Corinthian church had done that, although it seemed like they hadn't. And if that person says, no, I'm not going to get out of this relationship, then you, you know, take it to the church. And say, you know, so-and-so is living in this relationship, or so-and-so is known for this. We've talked to them. We've addressed it privately. They refuse to repent. And we're asking for their removal from the church. And if they repent, we're going to accept them back in. And that, in a sense, Gina, is really a grace act, because your goal is to get them back, right? Your goal is to get, you know, in some ways, Paul's like, turn them over. Let them live it out. Let them see the consequences. And it seems in the second letter that this person did come back. There's some who've viewed that probably happened. But I think it's a balance, Holly. Obviously, we have to meet with unbelievers, and we obviously may go to dinner with them, and that's great. You know, I have a friend who is an unbeliever that is probably going to be spending the next couple days with me. You know, I pray for him daily. He's going to drop F-bombs around me occasionally. But let me say that the reason he will tell you he is not a believer is because his father was a children's minister in the church. He grew up in the church. His father would go and do children's ministry, then go out and smoke pot in the parking lot, and then go back into the church to do some more lessons. And the church just thought his father hung the moon. And apparently they knew about his other life, but they did nothing about it. And so my friend's like, that's why I don't believe. So, you know, and, but I, what he told me the last time we talked was we got on this subject. I know we got to wrap it up, Neil, but, I said, well, you can't look at your dad. You've got to look to Jesus, and you've got to look at who Jesus is. And he said to me, he said, you know, you're the only pastor that I'm a friend with. And he said, the reason what I like about you, Jim, is you always keep going back to Jesus. And you're not sitting here yelling and screaming at me. You just keep pointing back to Jesus. And I think that's what we have to do. You know, but obviously, you know, he's going to be staying with me for a few days, and we're going to have some great discussions in time. So I don't, again, Paul's not saying don't cut yourself off from the world. Don't cut yourself off from unbelievers. But at the same time, they should see there's a difference in us, just like they saw in Christ. So that's kind of really the end of this. And I know Neil's got to wrap it up. So again, just Paul reminds us real quickly that at the end of the day, God's the one who judges. And again, for what business is it of mine to judge outsiders? That's just a reference to people who are not believers, who are not in the church. Don't you judge those who are inside. God judges outsiders. Remove the evil person from among you. So we'll leave the judgment of those outside of the church up to God, okay? But the idea is, if you have people in the church who are living in unrepentant sin, the church has an obligation to deal with that person. And I agree, Holly, Gina, we need to deal with that person in truth and grace, right? Jesus was 100% truth, but he was also 100% grace. And I believe there's a process for church discipline. Jesus lays that out. But there can come a point, and I know some churches that have done this, where they've had to expel people with always the goal of restoration if they'll come back. All right, so we didn't get to chapter 6. I was ready, Neil, just in case. Next we get to talk about suing each other. But I'll leave that up to Pastor Andy.
Well, you know, that is one of the beautiful things, as we pointed out earlier. You know, there's how many, 15 or 16 chapters here in First Corinthians. It's a long epistle and largely around the divisions. So, yeah, as you're pointing out, next week we'll talk about how they're suing each other. So there's all this wanting to vote people off the island. And yet then there's this other thing that they're so proud of, you know, that they're known for, of the immorality there. Yeah, so we say, oh, well, at least that's not us. Well, let's see. You know, so a question I had is, hey, it's our weekly question, you know, of, hey, it's Friday at Clay Terrace. What do we do with this? Well, we look back at Corinth, and we know from history and other records, you know, it was an immoral city. And so here's the church that's being accused of being immoral on this one thing in particular, and the city. So the question is, did the city impact the church, or did the church fail to impact the city? And I think that question is relevant to us today. You know, so if we watch the 6 o'clock news or whatever, and we go, oh gosh, it's the end times, how terrible our culture is. You know, hey, let's church at Corinth, let's take a look at ourselves and see, to what degree are we being a city on a hill, you know, a shining light. Paul in another epistles called the Christians then shining stars in the universe as they hold out the word of life. So that's my takeaway is, hey, what are we doing to shine brightly in our culture? Are we known for the wrong things? And we're going to talk about it next week. Are we suing each other? Or are we dividing on anything and everything? So I'll leave that out. But as we always do, I'm willing to give the last word to one of you who's willing to pray us out then. So who would like to have the last word and pray us out? Take yourself off mute if that's you. Hey, David, Sharon, we haven't heard from you this morning. You got any last words for us?
I have a lot of last words, and I don't want to keep everybody, but this topic is near and dear to my heart. What Jim was saying is something I've dealt with at a church recently. I say recently, it's actually been a while. We had a leader of the church, that a female that ended up having a relationship of, I don't know how to put it, with another member of the choir, female. They both had kids, and I advocated for her to step down from her leadership position. And I was called judgmental and insensitive and intolerant, and how we need to embrace her instead of asking her to step down and what have you. So I wish we had more time to talk about that, because I would have loved to have heard Pastor Wright's viewpoints on that.
Well, he may be back with us next week, hopefully, and maybe Andy will allow you a moment to address that. David, could you pray us out, and you can mention that and or pray for wisdom, whatever. Are you willing to pray for us?
I am. Well, let me also mention real quickly that I love what Jim said about not being a sinner. He sins, but not being a sinner. I had talked to people about, I'm not a liar. I've lied, but I'm not a liar. I'm not a thief. I've stolen. But it's not who you are, it's what you do. And sometimes
when we call people sinners, we're labeling them. We're labeling who they are and not what they do or what they've done. So I never associated it with sinner, but I really appreciated what he said. With that, let me pray us out. Heavenly Father, thank you. First of all, thank you for Neil's leadership in this group. Thank you for Jim and his word this morning on 1 Corinthians 5. And we really appreciate, Lord, the lessons that we've learned, not just today, but over the last several weeks with this passage. And just help us to have discernment to know who to associate with and to what extent we should be associating with them. And we just pray for the Holy Spirit to intervene whenever there are questions. Gina asked some really good questions about how we interact. And sometimes it's not a matter of interacting, it's a matter of aligning. And certainly we're called to interact with those that are in the world. But as Pastor Wright pointed out, we're to be not of the world, but in the world. And then there's also the passage in John 16:33 that talks about how you have overcome the world and how we should take great joy in that. So help us to see that as we take on this weekend and the week to come. Once again, thank you for those on this call and those that couldn't make it. We pray that you would be with them and just give us a good day. And please bring someone in our path who needs to hear the good news of your son, Jesus Christ. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.